These fans actually beat out the Fantech's T30s. Sort of. I'll explain in the review. Welcome to Machines & More. These here are the EK Loop FPT 120. It's a new fan this year. Some of you might be familiar with end-of-life Vardar fans from EK. These are the successors, and based on my experience with those fans, these are going to be a huge improvement. And big thanks to EK for supplying the fans for the testing. I am not paid by them for this review, and you can expect an objective and well-researched and well-tested review here. Alright, so EK's goal here in replacing those Vardars was to make a high-end performance fan. As a well-known liquid cooling specialist, EK has thrown in plenty of features that optimize this fan for liquid cooling performance, specifically on a radiator. The Loop FPT 120 is a 120mm fan in the new Loop series, measuring in at around 27mm thick with the rubber pads. And that's going to be similar to something like the Noctua A12x25, considering the vibration pads. There's also a 140mm version of this Loop fan. FPT stands for Full Pressure Technology. EK's intent for this design is that the entire frame of the fan should sit flush on the radiator so that you minimize the leakage. There's a very thin rubber pad, though, and that's going to offset it just a little bit. It is thinner, though, than the NFA 12x25 rubber pads, and that's going to allow these to sit closer. So I found that in practice, it's not perfectly flush. You'll still see a gap here, and it's not until you use a gasket like Noctua provides on their A12x25 that you'll see an airtight connection, although this really isn't too bad at all. The corners of the frame have added struts for stiffness as well. They're hollowed out, but I think this is interesting visually. The ones that EK sent me are the DRGB version, and I know plenty of folks don't care for the RGB, so they also offer an all-black version, which looks pretty sleek. It's the same one they use on the dark version of the Nucleus AIO. Here you've got 7 fan blades. The RGB ones are translucent to diffuse the lighting effects from 9 LEDs, which are situated on the bottom underneath the fan. Other features here, fluid dynamic bearing, which works to keep the assembly properly lubricated over the life of the fan. These fans also use EK's OmniLink. It's this 8-pin microfit connector that shares both the 4-pin fan and the 3-pin DRGB signals downstream to additional fans. Your first fan will need an included 500mm adapter cable, which will hook up your fan and DRGB header on your motherboards or to your fan / RGB controller. So pros of this, it does save a considerable amount of multiple cables by consolidating both the RGB and the fan cable into one short section. Cons, this connector, it is quite large, and if you can place it on the blind side of your radiator, it's easy to conceal. Otherwise, it's actually a much bigger connector than a regular 4-pin fan connector. And if you don't want a daisy chain, then you'll be left with a set of big connectors where you connect to the adapter cable, right? And because you need this, and also the unused end that was meant for downstream fans. So I haven't seen it yet, but from what I understand on the non-RGB version of this fan, they also use this 8-pin connector. So even though you don't need to bridge the RGB signal there, you still have the same connector and you have more added bulk. So that's just one thing to consider. The spec RPM range is 550 to 2300 RPM. The ones I tested, they actually got up to 2400. There's some implied variant to the spec here, but that's around about what you can expect. So they're not quite as fast as the 2600 RPM Linley P28 or the 3000 RPM Fantech's T30. But the reality is, though, for how loud the perceived noise increases as you get into the higher reaches of the RPM levels, this already cuts it off at a point that is still well above where I think most users should be running their fans. So to test these out, test out their performance, I set them up on the same system where I tested the Linley P28 against the T30s and the Noctua A12x25s. This is just the Dan A4H2O with open loop. We have the 30mm Hardware Labs GTS240, which I will note, it is optimized for slightly lower fan speeds, but it's really an all-around radiator. It sees good improvement as fan speeds increase as well. 270 watt load here from the 7700X and the 3070 FE for 1440p gaming. These are noise normalized or noise equal results based on the equilibrium coolant temps. At the quietest level, the loops can spin at the same 1200 RPM as the Noctuas. However, the performance is really just average. It's just okay here. They do trail the A12 by 25 by a noticeable gap. And just a footnote, the P28s, they are restricted to a lower speed because of an uncharacteristic noise that occurs at these lower RPMs. So if the intent is to run at a low to moderate speed, performance here probably isn't going to be that great. If you do kick them up a little bit though, that's when these really shine. And yeah, at the 1600 RPM level, which is a medium high RPM level, the loops beat out the thicker T30s, the thicker P28, and the A12x25. It's looking pretty good here, right? The band is pretty tight here. From top to bottom here, there's only a range of 1.5 degrees. So for an AIO that often doesn't need to run any faster than this level for many consumer CPUs, this is going to be a fantastic choice. And for it to beat out the T30, it's doing really well. Now you know why EK developed this along with the Nucleus AIO. Speed it up a little bit more to 1900 RPM though, it doesn't improve much. And the other fans, they do pick up steam with this RPM increase. So at the roundabout 2000 RPM level for these fans, it does lose quite a bit of ground, but it's still within a degree of the Noctuas and the P28. So while you'll see optimal performance at around 1500 to 1700 RPM outside of these levels, it's not terrible, but the other fans, they will give you better all-around performance. So this one can go to 2400 RPM though at the expense of some added noise, but keep in mind at that point, it still does not catch the Noctua at 2000 RPM. So I suspect that these fans had to be quite good when I tested out the Nucleus AIO, and after direct comparison here, that's definitely the case. For noise, I'll share the recordings with the fan on the Nucleus AIO, so just take a quick listen. So I had been using these next to me, pretty close to me, at different RPMs here, and even though the higher fan RPMs are, you know, louder as they should be, there were no irregular noise patterns to note, and that's what we're looking for here. Other small things I like about these fans, the EK logo, it's oriented differently on different sides. So this way it's right side up, on this side it's upside down. That's done deliberately. Coupled with the fact that you can adjust how the cable exits the frame, you can either exit this side or this side, right? Because you got a notch here, you just move it over. You should be able to get the logo upright, whether it's mounted as a push or pull, so you can just turn it to the right side up if you care. And also, you're still going to be able to conceal the cable, right? Because you can put that on the blind side. I'm not big on the decals they use for these though. It's not the end of the world, but having a decal like this on both sides, it's not the most premium looking finish. If you look at the fan, it doesn't have fancy things like airflow grooves on the blades. The EK's Vardar X3M had a lot of fancy things going on, maybe one too many. These also don't strive to have an impossibly tight tip to frame clearance like some of its competition, but EK still managed to make these simple, cost-effective, regular thickness while being a good performer on a radiator, actually extremely good performer, at least at a specific RPM. And they're actually not extravagantly expensive either, because the non-RGB version starts at $18 US and the RGB one like I have here, it's like 23. So it's really not that bad when you consider that the Leanly P20 is the next cheapest one at around $25 here, and the T30 and the A12x25 climb up past $30. Although the warranty is kind of short on these at just 2 years, so keep that in mind. And if you want RGB, this is going to be one of a few options in the high performance space, or you could just save a few bucks and go with the black one. So if you need a case full of standard thickness rad fans, these could be an excellent cost-effective choice. There you have it. These definitely surprised me, and so check these out if you have a chance. Hope you enjoy the review and found it helpful. If so, please give a like. Make sure you are subscribed to stay connected to more content like this. Leave links down below. Thanks for watching.